Hello everyone, welcome to today's video on comparing functions. So we know now what a function is. A function is a rule that assigns each input exactly one output, and we've split those types of functions up into two categories, linear functions and nonlinear functions. Linear functions are those that look like a line when we graph them. There's a constant rate of change that becomes the slope in graph form. And we can write them in equation form in slope-intercept form, y equals mx plus b, where a nonlinear function will still pass the vertical line test, but there's not a constant rate of change. It's not going to look like a line when we graph it, and we cannot write it in slope-intercept form. There will be often exponents or other special symbols that's making it nonlinear. So linear and nonlinear functions can be represented lots of different ways, as I just discussed, right? Algebraically, in equation form, numerically, in table form, graphically, and then verbally in words, like in a word problem. So we're going to look at comparing two different functions and pulling up the key information from each. So when we think about functions, there are two key properties. So the first is the initial value. All functions, linear and nonlinear, have an initial value. And that is often referred to as the y-intercept, particularly when we're thinking about a linear function. It's the output or the y-value when the input or the x-value is zero. Okay, so it's always going to be the point zero comma something, right? B is what we often say for slope-intercept form. It's going to be on the y-axis. And in a word problem, it's normally going to represent our starting situation. Because our x-value is zero, our input zero, it's like 0 days, 0 hours. It's the beginning of a process. So that's our initial value. And when we look at all types of functions, we can compare the initial value to try to understand them better. And then there's also the rate of change. So we know for linear functions, there's a constant rate of change, and that's called the slope. There's still like changes, rates of change for nonlinear functions. They're just not constant, so we can't give one number to it. And then just a reminder over here, we have slope-intercept form, y equals mx plus b, where y is our output, m is the slope, the change in y divided by the change in x, the constant rate of change, and we write that as a fraction. X is our input, and then b is that initial value or the y-intercept. Again, when we're thinking about linear functions. So we're just going to look at two examples, really dive into them. In example number one, we're comparing two different linear functions. Connor and Pilar are in a rock climbing club. They're climbing down a cannon wall. Okay, so I'm going to draw a cannon wall for us. You know, beautifully, I'm sure. Okay, so that's our cannon wall. Connor starts from a cliff that is 200 feet above the cannon floor. Okay, so this is going to be 200 feet. We'll make this Connor above the cannon floor. And climbs down at an average speed of 10 feet per minute. So like every minute, Connor's going down 10 feet. And then we see Pilar climbs down the cannon wall as shown in the table. For Pilar, we see at 0 minutes, Pilar is 252 feet above the cannon wall. Okay, so these are two different functions. There is the Connor function, which is representing Connor's location, his height relative to the ground, per minute. And then we have the same thing for Pilar. Connor's is just represented verbally, right? We're being told his in words. And then for Pilar, we have it numerically in a table. These are two different functions. They're both linear functions, which we'll see in a minute. So we're going to be able to find the initial value, the rate of change, and then talk about what they're saying. So first, let's just focus on Connor because we kind of have all the key information there. The initial value means where is Connor starting, right? How many feet above the cannon floor is Connor starting? When we have a 0 minutes have passed, where is he, right? So we know that that is 200 feet. Okay, Connor is 200 feet when he begins. And then the rate of change is saying, like, what is the change feet per minute? So we have here, he is climbing down at an average speed of 10 feet per minute. Okay, so that 10 feet per minute going down, that's our rate of change. I'm making it negative because it's going down, right? If it was a positive 10, that would be was climbing up the hill, but here is climbing down the cliff. Okay, so that's the key information. And while the problem doesn't ask for it, I could write an equation for this, the linear equation version of this in slope-intercept form. Because the rate of change here is my slope, it's m, and then b is 200, that's my initial value or my y-intercept. So the equation y equals negative 10x plus 200 is going to be our equation form of modeling this function. And we know equations are really useful because then I can substitute in different minutes for x and figure out where will Connor be. Now let's figure out the same thing for Pilar. The initial value is where Pilar is starting. It's the y value when x is 0, the output when the input is 0. And then let's find the rate of change. Okay, so I can do this. I'm going to find the difference in the x and then divide by the differences in the y's. From 0 to 1, I'm going up by 1. 1 to 2, up by 1. 2 to 3, up by 1. And then for my y's, or the height, she's going from 242 feet above ground to 234 feet. We're going down 8. From 234 to 226, again, we can subtract 8. And from 226 to 218, we subtract 8. Okay, so then her rate of change is the change in y divided by the change in x, is going to be negative 8 divided by positive 1, which is just negative 8. For the units, it's also going to be feet per minute. When we said negative 8 here, we really meant negative 8 feet. And then this plus 1 was the change in minutes. So negative 8 feet per minute. And the negative is just referring to the direction that they're going down the hill. So that's really the key information. Now they want us to compare them. So let's just look at the information and see what we notice. Well, comparing the initial value, Connor starts 200 feet above the ground, and Pilar starts 242. So that means that Pilar is starting above Connor. So in other words, Pilar starts farther away from the ground than Connor does. Okay, and then what's happening with the rate of change? So Connor's rate of change is negative 10 feet per minute, and Pilar's is negative 8 feet per minute. So that means that Connor here, for our rate of change, is going down, and they tell us this, 10 feet per minute, whereas Pilar is going down 8 feet per minute. So Connor is going faster. It's because 10 is greater than 8. The fact that it's negative, you know, that might throw us off. But again, that's really just talking about the direction here. So Connor is going down faster than Pilar is. Connor is climbing down the cannon wall faster than Pilar is. If we wanted to, we could be more detailed and say that Connor's going like 2 feet per minute faster. And for the initial value, we could have said that Pilar starts 42 feet above Connor. But not necessarily necessary here. We just need, all right, awesome. So those were two linear functions. Now let's go to our second example. We're going to compare one linear function and one nonlinear function. Roberta and Jennifer are both trying to save money to buy a car. Classify their savings as either linear or nonlinear functions. Then compare the functions and their meaning in this scenario. Okay, so the first thing they want us to do is classify these functions as linear or nonlinear. So we can start with Roberta's. We're seeing this in graph form. And for this in graph form, it's pretty easy to figure out whether it's linear or nonlinear. Linear just means it's a line. We're pretty good at this already. So for Roberta, this is a linear function because this is a straight line. Okay, then let's go over to Jennifer's. Jennifer's we have in table form. Again, when we see a table to figure out whether it's linear or nonlinear, we need to figure out if there's a constant rate of change. So I can see for my change in x, it's pretty simple. We're just going up by 1 week. And then for the change in the y, we're going here 20 to 40. That's going up 20. 40 to 100 is plus 60, 100 to 120, plus 20, 120 to 125, plus 5. So for Jennifer, it's going to be linear. If there's a constant rate of change, we can say when x increases by 1, y increases by this number always. Or if we do not have a constant rate of change, it's going to be nonlinear. So in this situation, do we have a constant rate of change? No, right? So this one's going to be nonlinear. Okay, so Roberta's function is linear, and then Jennifer's is nonlinear. Then we're just asked to compare the functions and their meaning in this scenario. So now let's really dive into what we're talking about here. Our x variable, our inputs, is the number of weeks. And then the y variable, our outputs, is the amount of money saved. So they're both trying to save money to buy a car, and these are modeling how much money they have saved in their bank account. So for Roberta, at 0 weeks, we see this point on the graph, 0.50. Okay, so that means after 0 weeks, Roberta has $50 in her bank account. And then we look over at Jennifer's. We don't have it graphed, but we can get the same information from the table. After 0 weeks, Jennifer has $20 saved total, right? So if we were to plot that, that would be like 0.20 right there. Okay, so for comparing this concept, the amount of money saved at week zero has a special name, one of the key properties of a function. This is the y value or the output when the input is zero. What do we call that? Right, we call that the initial value, okay, or the y-intercept. But more broadly, for nonlinear and linear functions, we're going to call that the initial value. So I'll write that. Roberta has an initial value of 50 or $50, and Jennifer has an initial value of 20 or $20, meaning that Roberta has more money in her savings account in the beginning. And then we want to think about the rate of change. So we already kind of talked about Jennifer's rate of change, right? When we were finding these changes, it went up by 20, then by 60, then by 20, then by 5, and then by 5 again. I might have said 10 the first time. It should have been 5. And then 5 again, right? So there is not a constant rate of change. So there is, you know, we are seeing the inputs. So we are seeing the change, but it's not constant each time. But for Roberta's, there is a constant rate of change since it's linear. And we can figure what that is. It's the slope of the line by picking any 2 points on the line. So say this point and this point. After 3 weeks, Roberta has $80 in her account. And after 5 weeks, she has $100. The change in Y is $20. That's the increase of $20 over a 2-week period. So after 2 weeks, she saved $20 more. That means that Roberta has a slope of $10 per week, okay? Or the rate of change is every week she's saving $10. And you can see that here. We go from 50, 60, 70, 80, 90. So she's saving $10 per week. Jennifer isn't going at that same linear situation. Sometimes it's 20, then it's 60, then it's 10, then it's 5. In the real world, there are people that save like Roberta and people that save like Jennifer. Some people will be very consistent every single week. I'm going to put $10 away. But then other people, maybe 1 week they go out to dinner, so they have less money. 1 week they have to pay for a gift for someone or presents. They have less money. 1 week the gas bill is hard, so they have less money. Or it's low and they have more money. They don't have anything special going on, so they have some extra cash, so they'll save more that week, right? So there's both a linear and nonlinear approach to saving money in the world. And both happen and both are totally fine. So then I can just write a final wrap-up sentence that Roberta saves $10 per week, but Jennifer saves a different amount of money each week. Okay, that's all it is. Great job, everyone.